I invite you to turn in your Bibles to 1 Peter chapter 2. We're going to read verses 18 through 20 as our text this week, so if you're able to, please stand with me in honor of the reading of the Word of God. 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning in verse 18, it says, "Servants, be submissive to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and gentle, but also to those who are unreasonable. For this finds favor, if for the sake of conscience toward God, a person bears up under sorrows when suffering unjustly. For what credit is there if, when you sin and are harshly treated, you endure it with patience? But if, when you do what is right and suffer for it, you patiently endure it, this finds favor with God." Would you pray with me, please? Father, I just thank you so much for just allowing us to come and worship you freely. We just thank you for the fact that you've given us this facility. We thank you for the believers who are here. We lift up our friend, our brother Harry, to you, who in the next few days will be undergoing some surgery, some significant surgery. And Lord, we just ask again, as Mark already has, that you just touch the doctors and nurses and the instruments who are involved in this, and pray that you'll just restore him to health as quickly as possible. So we pray now as we dive into your word, we pray, Lord, that you'll be honored, that you'll be glorified, and we leave this in your hands. In Jesus' name, amen. Please be seated. Most of us are aware of the fact that Scripture is our foundational source for ethics. And when we approach an ethical dilemma, or even just a serious ethical issue, then our approach must line our behavior with our beliefs, which are prescribed in the Bible. And so the Bible becomes our operator's manual, if you will, for everything in life. We believe the Bible was inspired by God. We believe that it contains no errors. We believe that it can never fail, and in fact, it is sufficient for every aspect of our lives. Within ethics, biblical interpretation becomes an important part. In order for us to determine our political positions, we try our best to align with people who follow biblical principles. Interpretation requires some work, and it may be tricky at times, but you can build arguments just to kind of show you how this can become tricky. You can build arguments that are both pro and con using Scripture on issues such as slavery, or Sabbath, or war, or women. There are all kinds of different things you can make pro and con arguments and use plenty of scriptural references on both sides of the argument. And you'll find that things changed once Jesus came to earth. When you flip from the Old Testament to the New Testament, there's a change in direction, obviously. You'll also find that Scripture will record some things without necessarily endorsing them. You'll also factor in issues such as the historical culture and climate of the day, and then things like that. But you'd have to totally have your head in the sand not to notice that ethics have changed drastically since the middle of the 20th century. And interpretation is involved in that. About, let's say, around, just for round numbers, 1950 or so, the shift occurred primarily because the Bible became less of a factor within the culture in determining ethical standards, and the reader of the Bible grew significantly in importance as far as the culture is concerned. It doesn't really matter to a lot of people even today. Now, this started in the 50s, but today it's gotten much, much, much worse. It doesn't really matter what the Bible says. What matters is what I think the Bible says. And that's a problem. Because really what matters is what God says. That's what matters. I remember one time we were watching a rerun of the old sitcom, Everybody Loves Raymond. And there was one situation where the family walked in while Raymond's brother and his fiancee were, I don't have to hide this too much because there are no babies here right now, but they were engaging in premarital sex. And what was significant about this is the character, the fiancee, was clearly saving herself for her wedding. And then all of a sudden, everybody in the family was up in arms about the fact that that was out the window. And her response was simply, "I have decided that it's not a sin." Now, as you can imagine, that got a lot of laughs from the television culture. It's horrible for us to think about it. Because, I mean, it's just absolutely stunning when you look at the fact that things have gotten this bad. Because this particular character thought that she had had the right to make that determination whether something was sinful or not. Had nothing to do with whether God said it was. But God's word clearly says that things like that are wrong. So it's sin, regardless of whether you consider it to be sin or not. And she had totally gone the way of the culture, and she had ignored the fact that our lawgiver and our judge is the only one whose opinion matters in the issues of determining whether or not something is sinful. But in the late 20th century, so you know, fast forward about 40 years or so, then the primary ethical background had become pretty much limited to equal rights. You've heard me use the phrase moral relativism. So moral relativism had become, even by that time, the culture of our country. And so it got to where if people were taking issues with something, the main ethical issue was simply equal rights. But it has continued a downward spiral from the end of the 20th century as now we're approaching the end of the first quarter of the 21st century. But back a generation ago, people didn't really talk about sacrifice or privilege or things like that. We were wrapped up in women's rights. We were wrapped up in sexual rights or racial rights or immigration rights, and perhaps most memorably, working rights. Now, I doubt today if too many of us would take a stand against ideas of equal pay for equal work. I mean, this seems pretty basic to me, regardless of gender or race or religion or even age. And what happens is if people don't get what they think is due them, then they take it out on society or whatever authority is over them. Now, until they were sold a few years ago, there were some factories that I had contracted sales for, and they clearly paid their men more than their women, and they paid the older people more than they paid the younger people. It was clearly violating the American standards. But they got away with it. And then when you compound that with the work of labor unions, which is, in my opinion, has clearly outlived their usefulness. Today, most all American manufacturing has been sent overseas due to union activity and the demand for rights. We have strikes, we have protests, we have insurrections, we have rebellions against government, against companies, walkouts, all kinds of common occurrences when people rebel against those over them who aren't giving them what they think they have equal rights to. And the underlying mentality is this: everybody is equal. Now, I will have a right to everything, and if you don't give me what I have a right to, I will fight back. I will lead a mutiny against you, and I will harass you in every way that's possible so that I get what I think is coming to me. I will protest, I will strike, I will do whatever it takes. Now, where this hits us today is that demanding rights be met is in direct conflict with the Christian walk. Believers are to be concerned with submitting to God's will, as we saw last week and really the last couple of weeks. And this week, Peter's going to discuss submitting to the superiors in the workplace. God commands us to submit in order to prove that our real hope is in the life to come and not to our brief stay here on earth. So we fast forward to today, and the culture has greatly outnumbered us. You look at our parking lot, you can go down the street to all kinds of different places, and you see those places that are packed. I'm not talking about other churches. I'm talking, you know, other events. We're outnumbered today. We're drastically outnumbered. In this particular generation, as opposed to just a generation ago, and then two generations ago, going back to the 50s, in this particular generation, the tone is more toward antinomianism. And now, don't be afraid of that word. The Greek word for law is nomos. So that's the root of it. You know what, if you put the prefix anti, that sounds Texan just saying it, doesn't it? Anti. If you put anti in front of something, you know that that's a negating thing, right? You're opposed to something. So if you have law against law, so basically antinomianism is just a big word to say lawlessness. There is no law. Laws don't matter. This is the trend that we're into today. And if you doubt that America has gone there, notice the large group of Americans who now support abortion on demand, gay marriage, more than equal rights for minorities, indoctrinating racism into public schools and universities. We're more into indoctrination today than we are into education. We've made gender confusion and sexual confusion vogue instead of sinful. And you can easily think about the myriad of ways that our government has broken its own laws in recent years with no trouble whatsoever headed for the lawbreakers. And if you don't think that that's a problem, you remind yourself, you've seen clips of people riding bicycles into stores and stealing whatever they want because the government will not prosecute the thief who steals under $950. And don't think that that's reserved but just for New York and Los Angeles. That's happening down the street in Dallas. People are stealing stuff with no problem whatsoever from the government. It's everywhere. It's not just Dallas. It's not just New York. It's not just Los Angeles. It's everywhere where the government has become lawless. And we've done that because we opted to defund the police. Now, you remember verse 15 is the whole key to this passage. For such is the will of God that by doing right, you may silence the ignorance of foolish men. When we live the way that we ought to live in a society, we silence those who criticize Christianity. We silence those who criticize the Lord Jesus. We silence those who criticize our faith because we live such good, noble, high-quality kinds of lives in the society that they have nothing with which to criticize us. So to silence the critics of the faith so that the gospel may go forward and to even be convincing to the critics, we are to live a particular kind of life. And in that life, there is no place for rebellion against the government or against our employer. I can hear some of you grinding your teeth on this because you're thinking, well, I'm going to get what's mine. Be careful with this. That's not a biblical attitude. That's a fleshly attitude. Peter's challenge that we'll see here this week is he's going to continue in the area of authority and submission. Next week, God willing, we'll see he's going to use this powerful image of Jesus that I wish I had gotten 1 week faster because we could have this right before the Lord's Supper. But, you know, did work out. But, I mean, he's going to use this image of Jesus who submitted. There are times when we think we're too big to submit. We just have to remember Jesus submitted. And we have to follow him. These verses that we just read, these three verses that we'll look at in just a minute, focus on submitting in a work environment. Now let's look in verse 18. We'll see that we're to be submissive slaves. Submissive slaves. Verse 18 says, servants, be submissive to your masters with all respect, not only to those who are good and gentle, but also to those who are unreasonable. Now, let me just say this. When you just read through that, you're kind of going, wait a minute. I'm okay as long as my boss is reasonable, but when he's thrown in, I'm to submit to somebody that's unreasonable, that's a problem. Well, it's not. This is the Word of God. In the first century, most of the labor force came from slaves. When you read this, you can don't think of 19th century American plantations when you see the word slaves. Don't think that way. Don't servants either. Don't think of that. Slavery in biblical days was almost always set up for the purpose of paying off debt. And that's how you did it. I mean, now, having said that, if you think that sounds like your job, you're not far off. We work for other people so that we can what? Pay our bills, right? That's how this worked. If you went to the doctor's office and you ran up a big bill for your family and you couldn't pay your bill, then you went to work for the doctor. You became his servant until you paid off your bill. Now, I also have to mention very quickly here, this particular word for servant is not the same word that's used over and over and over in the New Testament. That word is doulos, which is probably better translated slave. This is a different word here. This word is oikotai, which is in the same family as the words that we get, the English words house and economy. And this is referred to, you know, it doesn't matter. It could be a homeowner, it could be an estate owner or something like that. You kind of just became a house servant for these people if you couldn't pay their bill. It was not just simply cheaper and stronger labor, which is what slavery was built on in the 19th century, and even probably before that. This is how people paid their bills. And Peter is telling these servants here, and since everybody who has read Peter's letter since then, to submit. We saw it last week. It refers to voluntarily placing yourself under someone's authority. That's what submit is. And I mentioned this to you last week. Submit never means that you're to treat somebody or you're to be treated as a doormat. It doesn't mean that you're to be treated poorly. But remember, Peter is not a social philosopher. Peter is a fisherman turned missionary. He's not a social reformer, but he's a mouthpiece for the Lord. What he's saying here is, all right, he's not saying this. He's not saying, okay, you slaves, now you're all free in Christ, so get ready and go out on strike. It's not what he's saying here. Instead, he tells them to what? Submit to their masters. Now, this Greek word that's translated masters here is depotes. Obviously a strong word. You can hear that, just the word, the English word despot is right in the middle of that. It's an overly strong ruler who emphasizes absolute authority and unchallenged power. Now he's really talking about controlling people, which should sound familiar to us today. And yet he tells them to submit. And since he selected the present tense when he put this in here, he's not communicating about a once-in-a-while kind of submission. He's talking about a lifestyle, a continuous, characterizing lifestyle of submission. We're to be submitters. We're to be submitters. And we submit with good attitudes. Do you notice that? He uses the phrase here, with all respect. Peter doesn't approve here of bitterness or negativity or discontentment with someone's lot. He expected gratitude. In a lot of cases, servants were grateful to their masters back then because they understood that protection came along and provision came along with this relationship. Oswald Chambers, the great Scottish Baptist preacher of the early, very early 20th century, wrote, "Anything that savors of dejection spiritually is always wrong. If depression and oppression visit me, I am to blame. God is not, nor is anyone else. Dejection springs from one of two sources. I have either satisfied a lust or I have not." We're to be grateful for relationships that we have with employers and employees, because that's how we provide a living for our families. And Peter had already discussed the healthy fear of God that people are to have. And even those for whom there will be no condemnation because they're in Christ Jesus. This relationship of servant to master or employer to employee, if you want to use it in our language, was something that God designed after the fall in the Garden of Eden. The word for good here differs slightly from the word that we saw last week. This word refers to someone who is upright and satisfactory for the needs of others. And the word here for gentle describes someone who is reasonable and fair. When you put those two together, what you come up away with is sort of a magnanimous person. This is somebody who is supremely kind and gracious. This is someone who is easy to submit to. But not only are servants to respect the nice masters, they're to respect the unreasonable ones. Because anyone can do the former, it's tougher to do the latter. It's not so easy to submit to someone who's unreasonable. Now, that Greek word for unreasonable literally means crooked. You may be familiar with the fact that scoliosis is a medical term that refers to a crooked spine. This Greek word here for unreasonable is scolioes. Just one letter different from scoliosis. So you can see the connection. So it refers to somebody who's crooked. And Paul, not Peter, Paul has more to say on this particular topic. We mentioned last week the Ephesians 5:22, which is the verse that is the favorite verse for all husbands everywhere, right? This is just a few verses later than that. He adds this, Ephesians 6:5. Slaves, now that's that word doulos that I was telling you about a minute ago. Slaves, be obedient to those who are your masters according to the flesh with fear and trembling in sincerity of your heart as to Christ. Not by way of eye service, as men pleasers, but as slaves of Christ, doing the will of God from the heart. With good will, render service as to the Lord, not to men, knowing that whatever good thing each one does, this he will receive back from the Lord, whether slave or free. And masters, do the same thing for them. And give up threatening, knowing that both their master, with a capital M, their master and yours, is in heaven. And there is no partiality in him. Now, I don't have time to go a lot deeper into this particular, we're not studying Ephesians this morning, but this last line may have caught your attention a little bit. You can easily connect no partiality with equal rights, can't you? But notice quickly this business of eye service. We don't just do good when your boss is watching. Always do the right thing. And here, Paul is basically reinforcing what Peter says. We're to do it in the right attitude. We're to do it with sincerity of heart, as if we were serving Christ. And the mandate then becomes, instead of strikes or holdouts or protests, there should be submission. And if that makes no sense to you, then remember from last week, the key to the passage, I mentioned this a minute ago, is verse 15, where it says that this enables us to silence the ignorance of foolish men. This is where the peculiarity issue comes about. We're to be different from the world. This would give a godly testimony. It says patiently and humbly, I take whatever you give and I serve you with all my heart. And not only that, I commit myself to God who will properly reward me and you for how you treat me. In our environment today, people can always go and get another job. But not these folks. They were owned, get that word, owned until their debt was paid. And you couldn't just start sending out resumes back then. Leaving could get you killed. You may remember in the short letter that we have preserved for us in Scripture from Paul to Philemon. There was a runaway slave named Onesimus who made the mistake of leaving and ran into Paul in Rome. You're trying to run away from a master, and the first person you run into in Rome is Paul. I mean, so Paul tells us in that little letter, Onesimus gets saved, and so Paul is sending it back. And he's asking Onesimus, he says, you're a Christian. Go back to the man who owned you and serve him with all your heart. So the letter to the slave owner of Philemon, Paul says, accept Onesimus back. He became a Christian. I send him back with love. If he owes you anything, put it on my account. And Paul thus upheld that the slave was to submit to his owner, even though the owner and the slave were both brothers in Christ. Now you can imagine, your mind can do all kinds of what ifs that go along with that. Some are Christian, some are not Christian. One guy is, one guy isn't. That kind of stuff. It can create all kinds of combinations and all kinds of problems. Unless you have this attitude down. But the system stands large. The system stands in its place. Whatever kind of boss you have, you are to submit. I'm not getting a lot of amens on this. But this isn't open for debate. If you're thinking, well, what if my boss is cruel? Understand this. God will take care of your boss.
Amen.
By the way, Scripture clearly condemns the oppression of slaves. You can go to Exodus, you can go to Leviticus, you can go to Deuteronomy. Scripture is clear that slaves should not be mistreated. And you remember, back from the Old Testament, God instituted a 7-year release of the slaves, and then there was the 50-year, there was the Jubilee. And in the Jubilee, the slaves were released. Yet, God did not condemn people working for other people. Do you notice that? This doesn't go away. People still work for other people, but he always called us to submission. With a good attitude. Let's move on to verse 19. We'll see that we're suffering. We were to be about suffering sorrowfully. 19 says, for this finds favor. If for the sake of conscience toward God, a person bears up under sorrows when suffering unjustly. Now, again, we understand this verse better by remembering verse 15. The purpose of this is how the critics of Christianity can be silenced with a righteous life. And just as the church's bad behavior and appearances of evil hinder evangelism, righteous, godly living is the greatest platform for an evangelistic ministry. The life that you live and the life that I live are crucial to the impact of our message. When we respond in a godly way to ungodly treatment, then we take the honorable route. That's the mandate, and we need to live with it. Some of you doubtless will have to take a stand very soon. I mean, it just happens. It doesn't matter if it's big or small. We run into situations where we have to take a stance. But you should do it with joy, and the Lord will honor you, and the Lord will take care of those who are treating you unfairly. Now, that should have gotten an amen.
Amen.
I'm not saying that sometimes the employee's concerns are not justified. I'm not saying that. I've been an employee of family businesses, and there are times when the people are fair. There are times when the people are unreasonable. There are times when the people are disgusting.
Amen.
However, God requires that our attitude be right, and that we simply commit all these attitudes to God. We don't take vengeance ourselves. We don't demand our rights, and understand that God will take care of it. This is where faith comes in. Now, there's one other common motive for submission. We never want anybody in this world to think that we really care about the stuff in this life. When we saw Harry the other day, he told us he was ready to go home. Now, hopefully, very selfishly, I hope that he has to wait a while. But let's live at a level that communicates that we will endure anything in this life for the joy of the life to come. And we will never send out a message that we're going to get all worked up and upset the system and lose our testimony to get something here which is just going to get burned up anyway. And if we live that heavenly life, then we'll have the proper perspective. But this little phrase here, this finds favor, is literally translated, this is grace. This is a grace. God is pleased when Christians work humbly and submissive toward their employers, even when the employers are wrong. And notice the rest of the verse here. It says, whether it was an ancient slave being beaten by a master or a contemporary employee who has to grit her teeth and obey a hateful boss without retaliation, God is pleased. So allow the logical inverse. God is then displeased when we fail to submit to authority. I mean, I get it. This is tough stuff. We have our own senses of right and wrong, which come from Bible study, and our bosses a lot of times aren't involved in Bible study. And you can turn that Rubik's Cube any way that you want to, and it comes up that we're to submit to authority until, as we said last week, our boss's orders cause us to violate Scripture. If our boss's orders take us into sin, then we draw the line. The conscience toward God deals with a general awareness of His presence. Now just think about that. You've probably seen something on a news channel somewhere about the revival that's happening in different colleges around the country. They're experiencing the presence of God. Kind of makes you wish you were back in college, doesn't it? Let me think about that. No. But it does make me wish that it would break out. You know, I'm at the point in my life where, as you've heard many times, you know, I'm as convinced as I can be that we're in the last days. And we've kind of quit praying for revival. Wouldn't you like to see another one? Mm-hmm. Wouldn't you like to see it? So what's happening in these universities, and it's not just Asbury where it started in Kentucky. It's popping up at Cedarville and Lee University, and it's popping up in Christian colleges. You won't see this at the University of Texas, I can promise you that. But in the Christian colleges, this is becoming, it's growing and growing and growing. This is a wonderful thing. If it's sincere, it's a wonderful thing. And you just have to submit. You have to understand that you have to assume is the word I was looking for. You have to assume that it's sincere. But this is the conscience toward God that he's talking about here. They're in his presence. We're aware of God's presence. And we're aware of God's presence. When we're fully aware of God's presence, then we know that he's watching. And we're aware of the fact that God is there. But our action is prompted this conscious sense of the presence of God. You know he's there. And if you're walking with the Spirit, you know he's watching. You're familiar with the verse, and I'm sorry I didn't look this up, but when Paul writes in 1 Corinthians, he refers to the fact that your body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. And you know, there's so many people that interpret that to say that, you know, therefore, I need to do more sit-ups and I need to eat fewer donuts. That's not what this is referring to. My body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. So when I go to a movie that I shouldn't go to, I'm taking the Holy Spirit with me. That's what he's talking about. I have dragged God Almighty into a season, however brief it might be, of sin. My body's a temple of the Holy Spirit. Doesn't have anything to do with how much weight I need to lose. If you're walking with the Spirit, you know He's watching. And when you see the word there, bears up under, we need to think endure, persevere. Now, the word there for sorrows clearly implies pain, whether mental or physical. God wants believers who suffer unjustly at work not to stumble in their witness, but to humbly and patiently accept that unjust treatment, because we know God is sovereign. And He knows what you're going through, and He knows why you're going through it. Finally, let's look at verse 20. We'll see that we're to suffer silently. Suffering silently. Verse 20 says, "For what credit is there if, when you sin and are harshly treated, you endure it with patience? But if when you do what is right and suffer for it, you patiently endure it. This finds favor with God." Now, there were no labor unions back then. There was also no Better Business Bureau. There was no OSHA. You couldn't sue your employer. And obviously, there were some nice bosses and there were some hideous ones. Just like today, just like every day since then. The point is that even though they didn't have a choice, they took what was dished out to them. I mean, just think of the worst boss that you've ever had, and he or she is a dream compared to some of these people. Peter says that you did right if you took what came to you, because you kept the testimony of the power of salvation to give a man an unquenchable peace and faith in God no matter what happens. The bosses would see that you're immovable, that your faith is strong and your courage is great, and no matter what happens in that environment, you stand in the peace of God, totally trusting Him in a quiet spirit, willing and eager to be the best employee that you can be. And besides, it should never be said of a Christian that he or she was a bad employee. Now, they may not like our looks or our faith or something that we can't control, but speaking of ethics, it should be said of believers that we have a great work ethic. Not having one is a bad witness. And then Peter expands the thought with a negative and positive statement in this last verse. It's a negative rhetorical question. You can convince yourself that you deserve special treatment when you sin and are harshly treated. You endure it with patience. You shouldn't expect a gold medal for doing your job. And Gail and I saw a movie about the golfing legend Bobby Jones, who once called a penalty on himself for something that no one else saw. And when the reporters quizzed him about it, he said, "Do you expect a reward for not robbing a bank? If you sinned and you're being punished because of something you did, then there's no virtue in taking it patiently. But on the other hand, if when you do what is right and suffer for it, you patiently endure," Peter's going to repeat the same phrase. We've seen it twice now, right? This is a grace to God. This finds favor with God. God isn't particularly pleased when you're patient and you deserve the pain, but God is very pleased when you're patient and you don't deserve it. Some of you have employment situations that are not fair. Some of you are enduring suffering. The Greek word here literally means that you're harshly treated. It's a verb called aphizome, easy for you to say, which literally means to punch with the fist. It's used in Mark, as Mark is describing some of the repeated harsh beatings that Jesus took right before the crucifixion. He says if you're being beaten up roughly and you deserve it, then your patience is not a virtue. But if you don't deserve it, then your patience pleases God. So the motive for endurance is that it pleases God to see us accept the difficulty with complete faith in Him. Because, listen, this is a testimony beyond all testimonies. How you respond to situations like this. More than any eloquent theological presentation about the atonement or the imputation or the propitiation, suffering silently while going through trials is a great witness. It's a great witness. Whining and criticizing the boss is a bad one. Now think about it like this. What happens if Christians rebel? What happens if Christians retaliate? What happens if they demand their rights? You know what that says to the lost world? That says this life on earth is more important to us than our future eternal life in heaven. And since you're mistreating us, we're going to rise up against you. Is that what we should do? Besides, it should also send a signal to the world. And it would also say, God hasn't done anything to us, this, so we're going to have to go out. We haven't gotten this deal that we want, so we're going to have to get it ourselves. Where's the faith in that? Because if that's how we think, if that's how we think, we're no different from the world. The world can act that way. You were called to suffer undeservedly and to endure it with patience. Paul writes this, you may remember this, 2 Timothy 3:12. All that live godly in this present age shall suffer persecution. It's part of the package. But listen, this is another one of those things you'll never hear from the prosperity gospel folks. This doesn't sell books. Did you get that? All that live godly will suffer persecution. Sell a book with that as your title. It won't work. It's not going to draw big crowds. But that's not a trap we need to fall into. Our motive for suffering silently is that it pleases God. And thus, God will bless us for being faithful. But there's great freedom in relinquishing our rights. And I admit that sounds counterintuitive. We want to cling to our rights, right? But understand, when you came to Christ, you asked Him to save you, and you also asked Him to be the Lord of your life, which means you agreed to submit to His authority. Unlike the first century slave owners, He will never physically beat you, but He may put you through some trials that may make you wish for a physical beating. We submit to His authority and to earthly ones as well. Next week we'll see how Peter offers the life of Jesus as Exhibit A. If you need a model to follow in the path of suffering patiently and submitting under authority, then look no further than the Lord Himself. Would you pray with me, please? Father, we thank You for this timeless and important, although bitter to our flesh, message. We thank You for this particular passage that reminds us of how we need to submit. Not begrudgingly, but willingly and with a good attitude, with good respect. So we pray, Father, that You will teach us with each trial that comes along our way how to submit. And we thank You for the example that we have in the way that Jesus submitted so that we can understand it better. We ask that You receive this this prayer and our time together as an offering of worship. We commit this to You in Jesus' name. Amen. Mark and Taylor are here. They're going to lead us in a hymn, a verse of a hymn of invitation. If there's anybody business that you need to do with the Lord or with the church, I'll be down front. The invitation is open.